This is Paul Pearson, host of Star Time. And when I'm not using my GPS to navigate the land of a thousand dances, I'm listening to Rainier Avenue Radio .world.
And welcome to our live studio audience for another exciting edition of
Did You Know?
And here we go with round one.
Did you know?
COVID vaccine is free and easy to get. You don't need insurance or an appointment to get your vaccine. Vaccines are available at many locations near you.
And now we're going to double the value.
Did you know?
The COVID-19 vaccine is always free of cost. You can visit pharmacies, community health centers, and other health providers in your neighborhood.
And now for the lightning round.
Did you know?
The Delta variant of COVID is a mutation that has health experts worried because it's twice as contagious.
Then for our finale.
Did you know?
The best way to protect yourself from the COVID Delta variant is to get fully vaccinated. Get your vaccine today.
Find out more at kingcounty.gov/vaccine.
Did you know?
You're listening to Rainier Avenue Radio .world. I'm Granville Emerson along with my partner, Renault Pepe
Bean.
And we host the show Little Line Sports right here on Rainier Avenue Radio .world, where we talk about football, basketball,
local sports,
national sports, Seahawks,
UW,
Seattle U Redhawks,
Garfield Bulldogs,
all that and more right here on Midline Sports on Rainier Avenue Radio .world.
What is the Delta variant? It's a faster, more efficient version of the original virus that causes COVID-19. It's the same virus, it's just better at infecting people. Delta is far more contagious than its predecessors. It's spreading twice as quickly as the original strain, and people who are infected with it carry around much more virus. Getting vaccinated is the best defense we have against COVID-19, including against the Delta variant. Now check this out. The vaccine is free, safe, and effective. Time to protect yourself is now. Learn more at kingcounty.gov/vaccine.
Rainier Avenue Radio, your community radio station, will provide you with more information. Rainier Avenue Radio.
All right. Here we are. High noon on a Thursday. I am Mazvita Maraire. This is Seattle Sports Weekly. And we got another really big show for you. We always got a really big show. But this one is about as big as it gets because I'm just so excited. Got three guests. So, and we'll talk. This is our, what I call it, I said football show, right? Pun intended. But, it is a football show because we're going to talk about American football with Davis Chirwa. He's going to he was going to be on the show last week, but he was down in the Super Bowl. Imagine that. So he was covering that. So he's going to hop on and and just give an inside perspective for you all what it's like to cover the Super Bowl from a journalist perspective. And also you get a little starstruck. I was lucky enough to cover two Super Bowls, the Seahawks, both of their last two that they went to. And there's some really interesting stories that he can convey more clearly for you all. And, you know, when we hear about the halftime show and how big that was, a stroll down memory lane, hip hop, if you will. So some of our producers like D Money, a Fresh Juice, you know, I wonder one day to find out what he thought of that show. Cause you know, he's got that show, but you know, for all y'all, you youngsters out there, I think it was okay. I thought it was a good kind of tiptoe down, you know, hip hop, the beginning of it, not completely right. But just to give you a taste, because, well, you saw who was there, right? If you didn't, Snoop Dogg, Mary J., Eminem, and so on and so on, and Dr. Dre. So gave you a little, just a little tinge of music in terms of the hip-hop rhythm and blues. But music evolves. But no matter which genre you're at, right, there's a certain one. I also like hard rock and obviously reggae, which is Afrobeat. I love. My sentence there was in terms of I like reggae because that's the, you hear that, that's the beginning of the show theme and what have you. So, yeah, Davis would tell us. But I'm also just giddy to have two people. We're gonna two other legends, and they say birds of the same feather flock together. And these legends, I'm going to give my little intro to them and bring them on at the same time, because that's the only way. When you got two of the biggest stars, that's the only way you can bring them on. And the reason why I say that, they both are legends locally, in the community, in the state, and nationally. But when you talk to them and see them, you wouldn't know that. And they're also really, really cool people. And I would also say they're the global nomads of soccer. They really are. They can't get enough of the game, whether they're coaching, playing, or broadcasting. Now, we've had Peter Hattrup on, and he's going to come back on. You know, and we talked about Peter just in terms of, you know, his, yeah, I'll go again. 1984-86, FC Seattle. He goes to the Tacoma Stars, Seattle Storm, Portland Timbers. 1989 to 1991, Atlanta Attack Indoor. 91-94, Kansas City Attack of the Indoor. 1993, San Jose Hawks. I get confused with San Diego Soccers that came on later, but 1994-95, he's with the Sounders. And I think it's just one of the coolest stories ever that in 1996, he was the American Soccer League. He was drafted by the Tampa Bay Mutiny. Second round, but 17th pick overall. And then 1997, Dallas Burn. And guess what? He returns to the Seattle Sounders, 1997-1999. And 1997-2001, Milwaukee Wave of the Indoor, 2001, Seattle Sounders. Okay, that Seattle Sounder theme. I mean, you know, you can always go home on Hattrup's perspective. And also in terms of legendary coach. And I want to ask him if they play together, but legendary coach Pete Fewing. And if you didn't know that, Coach Fewing was over Highline High School, Green River, played there. And then he played at the UW, which is interesting because now he competes against the University of Washington. But he had a career. FC Seattle Storm, Everett Bigfoot. So, I mean, he dabbled a little bit, but I think I'll give a touche to the Hattrup in terms of a longer career. But, hey, we'll ask them both about that. And but his coaching is unprecedented. When you talk about – when you hear about the Krzyzewskis, you know, you want to talk about Pete Carroll. You want to talk – I mean, Bill Belichick, Ziggy Schmidt, Brian – Smetzer, pick any sport to win consistently. It's easy to win a championship one time. The most difficult thing is winning consistently, no matter where, what level you coach. Coach Fewing, Red Hawks, NAIA, 1997. 2004, undefeated, 22 wins, NCAA 2 champions. 2006, well, right. So he resigns. He now coaches. They were different name then. We'll just stick with the Red Hawks. So 2006, he resigned from after 18 years of coaching. And I didn't know this, but with Seattle U, because assistant coaches. He's, again, all those names, all those coaches I named, he's another one of those. Not only does he win, but he gets it, the staff, the value of your staff and your players. You're only as good as that. So we're not going to get into the personal thing, but the mutual parting of the ways, he resigned, and then higher pay for the assistants. So 2009, he goes and coaches the Kitsap Pumas, and they make it to the U.S. Cup. This is the weirdest kind of cool thing. So Coach Fewing is a broadcaster, and he's coaching the Kitsap Pumas. Guess who the Kitsap Pumas play in the U.S. Open? The Seattle Sounders, who he's broadcasting for. So he's got to do the notes, prepare, but then coach the team. And so 2012, he goes back to Seattle University, which, you know, yeah, some things are just a glove, a foot. I mean, that's the perfect place. You can always go home. And then 2013, the division title. He's got 3,000 wins in 2018. So, guys, can you just come on? Because I don't know what else to say. I could spend all day talking about your accomplishments. But Peter Hattrup, how you doing? And Sir Peter Fewing, how are you?
Doing well. I you can keep talking about us. I don't have as many good things to say about Peter, me, myself, as you do.
That's so thank you, great. Pete.
Yeah, Maz, thanks so much. That really kind of, ironically, I'm reading on my phone, I'm reading a Sports Illustrated article on Mike Krzyzewski before I came on. So how he changed his coaching style to work with the Olympic team, because he no longer with, college guys. He couldn't scream at him, he realized. So he had to treat him a little different. So I'll be honest. I don't put myself in that category with all those guys, but I respect all those guys. And this legend thing, I'm hearing this more and more, and I almost feel it's more an age thing than it is.
That's the same as saying old. Thing, yeah.
But it's very kind of you. So, and Pete and I played together, long history. And
No, let's go into that a little bit, because I think people need to understand that you guys are the closest of friends, but. Yeah. And so I want you guys to do your joking around on him. I just want to set the scene so the audience knows that it's all joking, you know, that you guys are really good friends.
Yeah. Well, and you did forget, Pete, what year were you American APL Player of the Year? Is that what it was? APL? American Professional? APSL?
No, it was the A-League. APSL. We kept changing names. I went through all the alphabets back then.
Yeah.
But that was 95, the year before MLS came along.
Okay. Okay. And you had a great year. I remember that. No. Yeah, nope. Peter and I played together. Pete, I got good news. I found the watch. So I have, Maz, we want to tie it. It's, hang on.
Yes, yes, yes.
He found it before and lost it again. So I didn't, until I get it, I'm not sure it's really there.
I got it right here. This isn't the one. This is not the one you're getting, Peter. But
yeah, see, that's what I mean.
Yeah, yeah. I got the watch. FC Seattle Storm. WSA Champions 1988. And Maz, I'm certain, and God bless our owner, Bud Greer, I'm certain he bought these on the airplane. You know, your logo here, $19, because
yes,
they were way cheaper than 19, I'm telling you.
Yeah, we'll take them. Yeah, but I found it. I found it. I somehow ended up with two. Somebody gave me another one, and I promised Peter a long time ago I'd give it to him, so.
Peter, what kind of player, because we're going to go in, I mean, you're a legend. I mean, what kind of player was Pete Fewing?
He's one of those guys that did all the hard work so I could jog around and take free kicks and try and score goals and do the fun things. So, yeah. You know, Pete was a worker with skill. You know,
thanks.
There's workers without skill and there's skill players without work. But yeah. Pete was a hard worker, had a great shot with either foot. Love to take a shot with either foot, but, and a good crosser of the ball. But Pete was one of those guys that did a lot of work to let those of us that reap some of the glory do our jobs.
Thanks. Yeah, Muzz, I never, you know, I played 6 years for Seattle in the FC Seattle days, right? And I think I rating myself as a player, I think my last year, because the game kind of slows down, and it was slower for Pete Hattrup long before it was for me. But I think I rated myself as the sixth or seventh best player on that. I think it was seventh best player on that team. And that's the highest rating I probably would have given myself throughout those 6 years. But I played and I knew to give it to Fran O'Brien. I knew to give it to Peter. I knew to give it to Chance. And I was fit. Someone talked me into running a marathon the night before, and I had never run 26.2 miles, and I ran it in sub 8 minute miles. So fitness was big for me, and my feet were pretty good, but I couldn't dribble past people like Peter. Peter could, you know, left foot, right foot, super strong on the ball. My job was to, you know, and I played a few different positions, but I think of George Carl on that. I think of Phil Jackson, you know, just role players who like to play. Right. Whereas Peter was super good. He could dictate the play. He could, you know, if we had a lead, he was smart enough what to do. I don't think my soccer IQ was like Pete's. And obviously you look at his career. Holy cow. I mean, had he not done his ACL in the MLS, who knows where that career would have gone, even in my opinion, and a lot of our teammates, and I'm not being nice because he's sitting there, but had he got not had the ACL in the MLS, it could have been there and then even national team stuff. So injuries are part of the game, but yeah, he was super talented and that was fun. I mean, I just decided 2 days ago yesterday, I'm going to go back to England. Yeah, I just decided, and I called my brother Ross. He's the oldest in the family. I said, let's go to England. And we got to do some really, we played, I think Pete, I think I went on the first tour and you went on the second one. Am I right?
Correct.
Yeah. I broke my ankle or something. I broke something. I broke my fifth metatarsal right before that trip. So I didn't go on the second one, but man, God bless Bud Greer. He gave us a, you know, five games, I think it was. And so,
yeah.
And back then, Maz, I'm looking at, I have in my office in 85, we played Dundee first game.
And wow.
$250.
Dundee United?
With FC Seattle. Yeah. It was.
Wow.
Yeah, Dundee, and then Santos, Pelé's old team.
That's right.
And somewhere I have a check that it's, you know, made out to me, and the part where the inscription of what it was for, it says Dundee. I framed it, Dundee and Santos, and so it's for $500. But yeah, I didn't have the career that Pete had. An indoor back then was really the thing, and he was very good. Every indoor team, Milwaukee. Didn't you have a long stint in Milwaukee, Pete?
Yeah, last 3 years before I kind of packed it in.
Yeah.
So. I was talking to Matt Pence yesterday, a good friend of mine, writer, writer at the Sounders thing. And we were, and I told him you guys were coming on. And I said, I don't, you know, I'm 60, just to kind of put it. Everybody that I know wanted to be Peter Hattrup. You know what I mean? If you were playing soccer, you were like, you know what? I mean, there wasn't something like he had a move or you heard or I mean, yeah, Peter, I don't know. For the audience, a prolific machine. Pete, can you talk about his ability to score and finish? Because that just it's unparalleled. I mean, you know, we'll talk world players, but it's unparalleled in terms of.
The thing was, I think Pete could score in a variety of ways. Like Chance Fry scored 100 goals as a pro.
Yeah.
Most of his were in the box, inside like 6 to 8 yards. He was excellent at flicking on headers and side footing balls and getting in the right spot. Peter was dangerous from 25 yards out. And it was, you know, if you cut off his right, you know, to the right, he could take it to the left. And then he was so composed, right? And when I said, like the game slows down as you get older, if you play long enough, you see things a little bit better. And I think Peter saw things when he was in college at SPU. I mean, he's a legend at SPU as well. So then, it helped put that program on the map. But his ability to score from in close, left foot or right foot, side foot or laces, you know, he had a repertoire of shots. And then you know, I don't remember a lot of goals with the head, but I knew he was strong in the air.
Not too many of them.
Yeah, but inside the box too, like the game slows down for you and you can put your foot on the ball. Pete was good at putting his foot on the ball, you know, when everything's chaotic inside the box. It's one thing to do it in your defensive half if, you know, they got a high you know, they put a low block and you're picking it up in the middle of the park and there's no one on you. That's one thing to put your foot on the ball, but it's another thing to put your foot on the ball at the edge of the box and dictate someone coming to you and then exposing him. So he was just calm before most guys were calm. And, you know, that's a handful of Seattleites that were like that. Very few, to be quite honest. So
my game's really slowed down now.
Yeah. I do remember once though.
It's really gotten slow now.
Yeah. Peter is super competitive. I think we were playing the Earthquakes, San Jose at Memorial Stadium. Pete, I don't think you remember this, but you said something to me and I said, shut your mouth. You say that again, I'll punch you in the face or something like that. But some comment, Pete criticizing my skill level in a way I didn't appreciate. So, and actually what's funny about that is I think that was the beginning of the friendship starting to, okay, I can't flip this guy crap. So Pete, do you remember that or am I making it up?
Not at all.
Was he serious all the time? Was Hattrup just serious? I mean,
well, super competitive, super demanding, right? All the good ones are, right?
Michael Jordan, yeah.
Right? The good ones are demanding. Hey, he won the ball on a certain foot with certain pace. He expected you to have his skill. And if you didn't, then he wasn't going to suffer fools on the field. There's enough talent around that you better do it right. I remember Gary Hill, I played a ball to him once and
That's right.
He was not happy with the quality of the pass. And I put it up around his knee and I said, I got you the ball. And it was an educational moment for me. It was FC Seattle. And he had such a tremendous indoor career with Tacoma. And he looked at me like I was an idiot. And he said, hey, I need it here. I went, okay, I get it. So Pete was really good about quality of pass, pace of pass, you know, when to take Pete. He could dribble and play one and two touch. We played at Memorial Stadium. It's like the carpet in my office.
Oh yeah. I played that in high school.
It might have been harder than the carpet in your office.
Yeah. What's that?
It was harder and
more
crowned. Your office isn't up and down at least.
So. Yeah.
So yeah, it was bouncing all over the place. So you had to have a really good touch.
Yeah. We played, I mean, it was amazing. Some of the teams we got to play back then. You know, I tell the kids that I coach now, we played against Man City.
Yeah.
I think we might have lost by a goal, but and they're looking at me like Man City, and I'm like, yeah, no problem.
Hey, Pete, I got a picture of it, and I got player of the game in that game because I had a shot from 25 yards out, and the keeper made a really good save, just a couple of hops, and he flipped it over the crossbar. So I had a recruit in from England, and they were from Manchester.
There he goes. Go ahead.
Yeah. So hang on. Give me one sec. Hold on. Yeah.
But, you know, that's the quality of the soccer was good. Just the pay wasn't very good.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and Pete talks about not having the career, but part of the reason is Pete had a life before I did. He had a wife and he had things to do. And, you know, I was to the point where, all right, where's the next game? And if it meant and in some of those years, it was pack up the car at the end of the season in Seattle, load it up with stuff. I'm driving to Atlanta, playing indoor in Atlanta, turn around, drive back home, playing outdoors in Portland, you know, wherever it happened to be. And, you know, that wasn't a life you could have if you were married. Well, unless your wife was an idiot, which luckily for Pete, Patty's not. So
yeah. I married a good one.
Yeah. It was a different world. And Pete and I go a long ways back, not only playing, but Pete also coached my brother at Seattle U. My youngest brother played for Pete at Seattle U way back in Pete's early days.
Yeah. I've got his picture. He unfortunately passed away a couple of years ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Ben was awesome. Super smart. Very funny. I think about him a lot. Pete knows that. I tell him every time I drive by the Roanoke, I think of Ben quite a bit. So, yeah.
I know the Roanoke.
Yeah.
Somebody plays soccer and then they move on. They're playing in a big pitch up in the sky somewhere for the
Let's. I hope so. We got a few. Unfortunately, we've had a few guys that have passed.
Now,
and I hope they are. That's what they're doing. And the game's so good, they should be able to. I'd love it if they're still playing. Yeah. I ended up coaching. I played 6 years. My last three, I started coaching here. So I really couldn't be as mobile. I don't think I was good enough to be that mobile as Pete was, but yeah. So look at this, you guys. Check this out.
Yeah.
So there's the picture. There it is. Look at those quads, right? Those are gone. And then I did officially get player of the game. I didn't know I had such a neck, but the guy I'm playing against is Neil McNabb. And it was great because one of our recruits came in and said, I said, oh, I played against Man City. And I showed him this picture and I said, were they any good back then? And the dad goes,
oh.
Yeah.
Oh, there he is. Hey, I just want to touch on something, Pete. I want to go back to what Peter said, you know, just being that, just wanting to play for the game, no matter whether it was Saturday morning at a pitch or whether it's packing up the car. I mean, just what, you know, what does that take for somebody like Peter? I mean, isn't that part of the makeup, though, to just love the game itself, no matter where you're playing, and go wherever a game is? Can you just talk about that innate trait and how that just shows who he is and his accomplishments?
Is that me, Peter, or
Peter? No, you talking about Peter's ability to I'll play anywhere, anytime.
Yeah. You know, and that's true. That is really true. I was just talking about Bruce Rioch this morning, who coached us in 85 for 1 year and played for Scotland and Derby County, had a tremendous career. And then went back to England, took over Middlesbrough, and ended up coaching Arsenal the year before Arsene Wenger got the job. So what he loved about the American player was just what you described, that we'd love to play. It wasn't about the money. When we went and played Middlesbrough, his new team in 86, 87, he said, you know, we stayed up really late one night just chatting. And he said, I own those players. I own them. I can make them work 16 hours a day. He said, you guys all had jobs. You guys just wanted to play, you know. And Pete really had a professional career.
In
the MLS, it was so great. Maz, I know you were there yesterday. The Sounders new opening at Long Acres, and it was awesome. But where the game was when we were playing, you had to chase the game. But – having said that, I know Peter's still playing. My playing days.
What?
Yeah. And he could step on and play. I mean, his again, touch, decision making, soccer IQ, quality, all good. My playing days are past me. I need knee surgery and I don't want to get it. So, he was a gym rat, right? And he was a basketball player too. And where's the next game to go compete? And you know, I, as a teammate of his, watching him go to Atlanta and Milwaukee and then into the MLS and then seeing his career extend, you know, when FC Seattle folded, it was 3 years of no professional ish soccer.
Yeah.
And FC Seattle was the highest. They paid us in our first year and our sixth year. And it was less, by the way, in the sixth year. But then it was gone for 3 years. And I tried to keep playing. I think I was 27 when it came back. But, you know, the Peter Hattrips, the Chance Fry, Bernie James, Billy Crook, David Hogg.
Billy the Crook.
Yeah, all those guys, you know, they – Schmatz, Brian, right? Those guys, they just were really talented soccer players. And Pete just – I know. I mean, if there's a – he would play anytime, anywhere. And I was the same, I think. But I think for him, you know, he got those opportunities. He didn't just say, I'm going to go to an open tryout. They wanted him, right? They wanted him to come and play. When FC Seattle folded, I remember calling the San Jose Earthquakes from my office. And I said, hey, could I, you know, I've been in the league, blah, 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 blah. And I said, could I come down for just games, you know, fly in for games? And he's like, man, I don't think we can afford you. Total bubkus. It wasn't they couldn't afford it. It was they didn't want me to play for him. So, but anyway, Pete, that's a compliment. I thought you were a gym rat, right? You wanted to play anytime, anywhere. And then uber competitive every time he stepped on the field, uber competitive. Because when he got A-League Player of the Year, he had had an off season the year before, whether it was injury or coming back from injury. And, you know, for him to return on that, to that level and take over the league and win the championship is pretty cool.
Yeah. Well, it's funny you talk about playing anytime, anywhere. There was a stretch between when FC Seattle folded in 1990 and the Sounders came back in 94.
Yeah.
I spent part of one summer down playing for a team called the San Jose Oaks, which was basically a glorified pub team. But Chris Dangerfield.
Who was on it, though, Pete? Who was on that team?
Chris Dangerfield was the player coach.
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay. Kate Iotti, Patrick's older brother, played for us. Yeah. He was still in college, but we had a pretty good team. The next year, 92, there was really nothing going on. And Chance, Billy Crook, Bernie, myself, Paul Retzler, some of these guys, we just played, Dick McCormick, ended up just playing in every silly tournament we could find. And I think I played in 7 different tournaments that summer. Everything from 3-a-side to the Kennedy Cup, which used to be a tournament for the top teams in Washington, Oregon, and British Columbia.
That's right.
And then this was FTI, and I think we won it about 4 times in a row. And sometimes we just get together, whoever was around, it's like, okay, who can go play this in the tournament this weekend? And that's what it was. But that was all summer. You know, I did camps for Cliff McGrath during the week, and then weekends, go play in the tournament, and then back up to camp. And, you know, I say, when you're single and you can get away with that. Yeah. So,
well, your girlfriend was soccer. I mean, that was the love of your life. You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
Look, I'm going to get in a lot of trouble, but that's okay. I think it's a great note to D-Money, as in the producer. Let's play. I know we're running late on the break. I know we got people coming, but you know what? They got to wait. Can we please play it's about 2 minutes. This is a great way to end the show, this segment. And we got to get you guys back. I debated whether it's 60 minutes or, but you guys are always regulars and welcome to come back. Pete, I just appreciate you always coming back. But let's play this Brian Smetzer, because that's another one we'll have to talk about sometime, speaking of Seattle and soccer and, you know. So can we play the video from yesterday about Brian Smetzer? Then I'll give you guys one chance to say.
Home is where the heart is. And this club has lived in the hearts and voices of the fans since 1974. We've lived in the trophies and in the tears, in the echoing chants and the scarves held high, no matter where we are. The Kingdome, Memorial Stadium, Starfire, or Lumen Field, we've given our full 90, and you've done the same. We built this club on a great heritage. Everything we've accomplished, we did it together. The goals, the heroes, the trophies, the memories. Through it all, you are the heart of the club. And as we approach our 50th anniversary, we're reaffirming our commitment to our heritage and our home. In 2024, we will open a state-of-the-art training facility for our players and staff. This investment is a promise to you. We aren't going anywhere. And we hope you aren't either. So here's to the last 50 years, and here's to 50 more.
All right, gentlemen, if you could, we got to go, but if you, in one sentence, as you say goodbye, one thing, whether it's that video or whatnot, and then we'll go on break. I'll start with up top, Coach Pete Fewing.
Maz, I saw that yesterday, and I got goosebumps, and I got goosebumps again today. Peter and I love Brian. I have pictures of him in my office. He's got the same photo in his, and he's a good friend and what he's done in the game. But, you know, I'm drinking out of this mug, and I use it every day, and that's 40 – this thing's like 43 years old, this mug. I gave one to Brian, and I gave one to Wade Weber. I had three of them. Sorry, Pete. But but the Sounders, I bet Peter and I could sit down and name 100 NASL Seattle Sounders easily, or, you know, the guys who have come through the game. So I thought that was awesome. The facility is going to be great. And it's another kudos to Adrian Hanauer and Garth Lagerway. I mean, that's another huge, huge step in this club's direction. So having been at the VMAC a bunch when the Sounders would train there, this is going to, you know, be similar, and it's just going to be phenomenal. And so really happy for Brian, because, I mean, you know, you saw Roger Davies wearing Sporthouse Schmetzer on his jersey.
Yes.
Awesome. I didn't recall them being – actually, I do remember them being sponsors at one point. So I think it was – it's great. It's Brian deserves – how he's not MLS Coach of the Year at some point in his tenure, I'm not sure. But what he's done and how he does it, it's awesome. So,
Peter Hattrup, I think he just crossed over a half volley for you. Can you just volley this ball in the back of the net? Take us home.
Yeah, I think the 50 years and going on to the next 50 resonates, I know, with Pete as well as me. But, you know, I went to games in 1974. My Little League Baseball coach took me to my first game down there. Mm. And I went to the post-game social and had soft-serve ice cream over in, I think, the Snoqualmie room or one of the rooms across. Little did I know, I'm sure the players were over there having beer, but I thought they were just like me and having an ice cream. I was a season ticket holder when they were in the Kingdome, when they have youth season tickets for $20 and you got a season pass and a team yearbook, and watched all those games. I was at the first game in the Kingdome. I was fortunate enough to play for the Sounders, and I was the season ticket holder when they started up again in 2009, and my wife and I are season ticket holders now. So, you know, this has been a part of my life for 50 years almost. And, you know, I don't know if I'll make the next 50, but, you know, I think they're going to be around and relevant for as long as I live, which is a fantastic thing for all of us that grew up loving the game in this area.
Absolutely. Thank you both. Just honored to have you on the show. We're going to go on break, and we'll talk to you later. That is two legends, Peter Hattrup of U.S. Soccer Legend, and of course, the legendary NCAA coach. That is Pete Fewing. He is Seattle University Redhawks men's soccer coach. All right, let's go on break, and thanks again, fellas. D-Money, take us home.
Thanks, boss.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Here with the Rainier Avenue Radio Traffic Update. You can listen to us in your car 24/7 anytime by downloading the free TuneIn app. Once you do, search Rainier Avenue Radio. And remember, do not curse out your fellow drivers. This has been your Rainier Avenue Radio Traffic Update.
My name is Keith. I'm a barber from Tacoma, Washington. When the pandemic hit, it did affect me as a business owner. I have my own personal reasons why I didn't get vaccinated. But I was talking to a doctor, and he was telling me more about what it could do to protect us and our family. I wanted to get back to that once was, right? I do feel safe knowing that I am vaccinated. I just hope what I'm saying is reaching into people's heads to know that this is the best decision for all of us. To learn more, please visit hereforuswa.org.
This is Big Poppy, host of Jazz from the Cabinets. Join me each week for a listening tour of the first century of jazz, an eclectic mix of Dixieland, big band, cool jazz, bebop, contemporary jazz, world jazz in all forms. That's Jazz from the Cabinets with Big Poppy on Rainier Avenue Radio, streaming worldwide on RainierAvenueRadio.world.
Greetings. This is your host, DJ Neftali, RainierAvenueRadio.world, the best DJ in the Seattle area. You can catch me every Monday at 8 p.m. on YouTube. Like I said, this is DJ Neftali, the best reggae in Seattle, Washington, the best radio station, Rainier Avenue Radio.world. Come on, right?
All of us have struggled through the COVID-19 pandemic, and many of our communities have been particularly hard hit. Some things definitely need to change, but a few things should stay the same, like protecting your child from serious diseases you can prevent now. Preventable diseases like measles, mumps, and whooping cough. Is camp, childcare, or in-person school on your family's agenda? Give your child a healthy and safe summer and school year by making sure they're up to date on vaccinations and well child visits. You have the power to protect. Call your healthcare provider to find out what vaccinations your child is due for and make an appointment today. If you need help finding a provider, visit parenthelp123.org or call the Help Me Grow Washington hotline at 1-800-322-2588. An interpretation is available.
You are listening to Rainier Avenue Radio.world. Don't forget to log on www.rainieravenueradio.world.
Hey, oh, that's right. We rocking and rolling. Woo, that was fun. That we had oh man, Seattle U legendary coach Pete Fewing, and then American soccer legend Peter Hattrup, and they were that was amazing. That was absolutely amazing, and the show must go on. It only gets more amazing. And Lars Hanson, come on in, my brother. I'm gonna get you real quick. You know, we're running behind. What's up, brother?
You know what? It was worth it. That was a really good. That was a really solid segment. You know, I'm a college football guy, but I love soccer. And Pete, that was a great segment. I loved it.
Well, they're legend, so I turned on the mic and let him go. So, yep. Yeah, no, it wasn't that. Yeah, thanks for hanging on in there, brother, and giving up the time. That usually we do our crosstalk. And speaking of legends, here we go. Now, this cat, I'm not even sure what to call him, right? Except my brother, Davis Chirwa. And I got to make sure the last name, because I'm saying in a Zimbabwean way, but he is basically a media mogul, right? And so not only does he cover the local sports, not only does he cover, there you go, my mission. My mission is a global ambassador for human empowerment to share my knowledge and vision of entrepreneurship by facilitating others' dreams becoming a reality. And he has done that, not only for himself, for others, and he's internationally. He is internationally known. So, my brother, sir, can you come on? Just, you know, we're going to get you going. And in terms of just all the stuff that you do, Davis Chirwa, welcome.
Thank you for having me, man. Thank you for having me. Good to see you, Lars. How are you doing?
good to meet you for the first. I mean, we're not meeting, but good to see you for the first time. And
right. It's a lot of pressure for us to go after all those legends, man. Mazvita, you know how you do that, right? To ask.
How do you do?
This is what we do, legends after legends after right. Legends. And well, so, I appreciate it. Yeah, thank you for you know, making it work in terms of the schedule. But I was going to say, where am I? I'm not going to do the notes, because sometimes you kind of have the notes on there. But, you know, let's go with D Money. See if you can play that clip from the one of Clint Dempsey. I don't know if you
know. Hey, what's up, Seattle? It's your boy Drew Ha. We're here with ATV at Steve Zakawani and Friends celebrity soccer match. It's like a lot of stuff going on. I have here the man, the myth, the legend, Mr. Clint Dempsey.
Say hello. Video.
How you doing, sir?
How y'all doing?
So how you enjoying the game today?
Having a good time, just hanging out with the fam.
It's for a good cause, and just having to show love.
That's right. Now, I know if we put you out there, the score would probably be like 40-0, because you just go. Are you able to play it friendly, or do you have like one mode?
I don't know, man. I think everybody, their competitive nature comes out. But yeah.
Wait for it.
Some of the guys that I played with, and you know, it's been some good soccer being played.
So far, who you have being the MVP?
Oh man, probably Marshawn Lynch getting that red card. That was nice to see. Eddie Johnson's been looking good. That's my boy. When I first went to the national team, We were roommates, and gotta show love to him. So Eddie Johnson's been looking good. Love it, love it. And our sidekicks here. This is Fifi, right? And Elise, want to say hi to everybody?
Say hello.
Hello.
She's ready. In the mic. And who? Yeah, man. All right, this is Drew signing off. ATV, have fun and enjoy.
Well, speaking of legends, right? Davis, take us from there, what that was, and then what you're doing now, and then we have some Super Bowl photos.
Absolutely. Oh, man, that was a surprise, man. You didn't give me an opportunity to actually know what you're going to play. So I was like, oh, my goodness. You took me back. Shout out to my boy, Steve Zakawani, for doing all the great work after playing all these seasons in Seattle. And, you know, I'm from Africa, so we dreamt all things soccer, right? You know, I remember growing up, people jumping off the roofs because their team lost and stuff. You know, that's how serious it is, Lars. Mm-hmm. You know, it's incredible. But
what country are you from? Hold on, now you can't just be Africa. Damn. What country are you, sir?
I'm all things Africa. I grew up in Zambia, and I have the Malawian origin as well. So it's part of Central Africa. And thank mm-hmm. you for asking, because most folks ask that, where is Zambia? Where is Malawi? We've never
Kenneth Kaunda.
Kenneth Kaunda, yes. Yes. Happy Black History Month, everybody, by the way. You know, okay. So you I got reminded because you said that, please. President Kaunda played a very big role. With MLK. Yeah. He used to come here. There are photos. You can research that. And as soon as you said that, I got a reflection of that. So that's why I said it. Yeah. So thank you for having me. But the clip that you just showed was one of the charity fundraiser that all different stars from soccer, from football and entertainment in Seattle, everybody comes together to raise money for different causes. And Steve Zakawani, that was his charity, you know, fundraiser, soccer match. That was fun. Marshawn Lynch was there, you know, right after he retired. That was incredible to have him. You know, Mazvita, you remember those days, you know, we used to just keep going. Yes, sir. But long story short, you know, I came from Africa. I didn't know anything about football, American football. All I knew was soccer, right? So moving with soccer knowledge here, I still had to find research, and I found out about the Seattle Sounders, and I've been a fan ever since. And alongside covering, you know, all these games, I ended up, you know, Mazvita, you create relationships with the players, with the coaches, and things like that. So with that said, we still now have to highlight what they do in the community outside the field. And so that's how Steve Zakawani and I connected. And I'm so proud to mention to you that if you look up his film, the film that he did after he retired, I was one of the people that actually filmed all that. So I had to go to Portland to do some of the filming for the coaches and some of the players. So it was incredible, man. It's such an honor for me.
Can we, D-Money, I think I sent you the link of channel ATV. Can we pop that up for a second? Then we'll go to Super Bowl. And then,
Hey, you're putting all the big guns for you.
You know what? I don't, you know what? It's amazing people that I work with.
Yes, and,
So absolutely. So let me go to D-Money. Can you pull it up? You know what? If not, I will put it in the chat, and maybe you could.
Absolutely. It that absolutely.
Way. There we go. And I think D-Money can. I don't know how there. No, you can. You guys see that? You can't see that. I'd have to share my screen.
They can see it. We can see it.
Oh, okay. Okay. There you go. There it is. So that. Oh, wow. So I'm scrolling through. I didn't know. I'm like, I feel like Captain Kirk now. I got the power. But, but I mean, anything, you know, there's just all the amazing things that are there. But you're talking about the your projects and the cancer awareness, African Film Festival, the Juneteenth celebration. You want to talk a little bit about those before we go to the Super Bowl and just the amazing things that you do community-wise?
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. It's kind of weird to be talking about myself because I'm used to talking about other people. It's kind of weird.
Got you.
Yeah. I believe when you are ordained to have a media platform, we have a responsibility to make sure that the community gets to consume things that we're able to see that they may not have the opportunity to see. So I've been grateful enough and thankful enough for all these amazing opportunities over the years. And each day I wake up, I feel like it's a brand new day. It's a great opportunity to do something great, you know? So having the opportunity to cover all these sports from soccer to basketball to the NFL and all, you name it. You know, we've done it all, but we take that with grace. We look at the game itself. You know, when you're at home, you're watching a game, you know, everybody sees what's happening in real time, but most folks don't know the stories of the people that are on the field. You know, what does Russell Wilson do when he's actually doing work in the community? What does, you know, my brother Mazvita do when he's not live on air? You know, things like that. So we follow those stories and we take those stories and share them to the community so they can fully understand the transformation between being on the field and being in the community. So I think over the years, that's what gave us the leverage. We have targeted, programs. So for example, breast cancer awareness, HIV and AIDS, you know, coming from Africa, I witnessed family members, friends, community members go through it. So I still have a responsibility to make sure that we shed light on that. Even now, when you talk about COVID-19, we still have been in the forefront to make sure that people are sensitized to, the vaccination and things like that with mixed emotions, but we still have a responsibility to make sure that people get the information and they can make a decision. So it's been a wonderful, wonderful journey all these years, through hardships and through failure and through learning, but we're here today, feeling good about what we've done so far. So in a nutshell, that's what we do.
Absolutely. All right, D-Money, man, I told you, I'm sorry, man, I got to put you to work today. Are we able to go through the pictures? Can we see those? There we go.
Oh, okay. Look at you. You did your research. Basically, you're looking at a picture of me and my brother, Mac B. Shout out to Mac B. He's actually a movie actor. He's based in L.A. I've worked with him during Super Bowls for the last 5 years. He loves sports, even though he's an actor. But so every time we get the opportunity to work together, I work with him. And so when you see me traveling, you know, we do have folks that work with us from all parts of the country.
The world.
Thank you for the correction. Yeah. So my brother here is based in Los Angeles. Like I said, he's an actor. So when we make that phone call, he's right there and he puts everything behind and we keep moving. So we also have other young ladies who work with us. They were live there on location. And you're looking at what's called the test of the NFL. So the test of NFL includes media coming together to test the food. You don't think about it. Most people don't think about it. To test the food that the players will actually be eating and the fans as well. So we give them their opinions. We give them our opinions on how we think the food is good, whether it's too heavy, it's too light. So we do kind of like cool stuff like that to make sure that, we are normal people, right? So we experience the whole thing other than just reporting on games and events.
Lars, looks like we got let's rendezvous for the next Super Bowl for the taste of the NFL. Yeah, go ahead. I think D Money's gonna go through these, and it's live, so
right.
Let's stop on this one. Let's talk. Tell us about this one, because this is a monumental type of a picture.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I wish you warned me, because I could have cued my mind to actually, but I would just flow.
No. Live.
So you're looking at a picture of me and the coach, the Washington Commanders now. Yep. Coach, the name changed for those of you that may not know, because it just happened a few weeks ago. But the coach of the Commanders, Rivera. Yeah, so this was an event by the NFL, but as you know, the NFL is going through a lot of diversity awareness for the community. That's a whole different thing. Come on, Mazvita.
Yeah, right.
So they had this event. It was called it's a Fritz Pollard Alliance, which is a nonprofit that brings together all the legends, basically people of color. And the coach here was supporting one of the ladies who's the first African-American to be a coach. You know her, the young lady.
We have the pick for her. Absolutely.
Yes. In fact, I would highly recommend that you actually interview her. She's a great young lady who is standing up for all the ladies and women and folks of color to make sure that the stories keep, moving forward, to include women in sports, all types of sports. So that was an opportunity that I had to sit down with the coach and talk to him a little bit about his processing. And because, as you know, he's very diverse. He picks his players carefully. He picks his staffing carefully. So that was a great opportunity for me to get the insight from a coach who's conscious, so to speak.
All right, keep going. Jennifer King, right?
Yes. Oh my goodness. Yeah, those are some of the photos of highlights of Snoop Dogg and Dr. Dre and Mary J. Blige and everybody else who was involved in the halftime show. And this was the first time that the NFL had hip hop involved in the history of Super Bowl. And so it came at the right time, at the right place. I see you shaking my head, my brother. What are your thoughts on that yourself?
This is really about you and just, your ability to be there, like you said, and tell the story. So I don't take anything away from that.
Right.
You know, it's funny. I wear my NFL sweatshirt and people in the community will go, ah, yeah. Oh, Jada, Jada Evans. Every time I wear my NFL, she's like, Lars, what did you think of the halftime show? Did you watch it?
I didn't honestly watch it, but I do think it was a really cool opportunity because you have Snoop, who's like the guy of LA. You have Dre, who was kind of in that similar mold. But then you also had Mary J. Blige. You had Eminem. It was a really eclectic mix, but I thought it was a good moment for the NFL.
Yeah.
Davis, and I'll let you continue. I wish they were just Lars, well done. I wish it was more about the musical talent than them trying to go, oh, diversity. No. You know what I mean? You're trying to cover the lack of black head coaches and general managers with this halftime show. Halftime show was beautiful. It was music. And stay there.
Yeah. Anyways,
keep going. This is your story, not mine.
Yeah, I agree with both of you. But the fact of the matter is that we have to get started. There she is. Beautiful, intelligent young lady, strong, she has a very strong presence. So that's another story that you can highlight maybe on your show at some point when the opportunity arises.
I don't have contacts like you, Bill.
I do.
Go ahead.
We know we can do it. Yeah. So Jennifer King, that's her name. If you want to look her up, you can read her story and find out more about what she's doing. And we have to get started. So we understand that it's a very sensitive and political, stance that could be put sometimes or across the board. But we have to get started. And that's a great opportunity for us to move from point A to point Z, hopefully, one of these days. Yeah.
And that's the difference, right? This is progress. This is absolutely progress. And that's kudos to the NFL and especially you for – because that Fritz Pollard is a big deal. It is a big deal. And for you all to cover that, it's more exposure.
Absolutely. And even just the connection to your point, even the connection, because we, like I said in the beginning of my statements, I said we have a responsibility to highlight things that are not so often put in the forefront, So it was all people of color in the audience. And Roger Goodell was there to make a statement. I'll send you that video that maybe one day you could play, and you should listen to what he said. And he agrees that the NFL has a long way to go before they can.
Sure, I got iMovie. I'll chop it up.
I'll send it to you, my brother. So, but honestly, coming from where I come from, from Africa, and to be here today and to do all these things that I've done over the years, sometimes if my story is being told, I always ask myself, who are they talking about? And I realize it's me, so you have to stay humble. You have to also create for opportunities. Don't get it twisted. These things didn't just fall on my lap. No. I had to work hard and make sure that I do my research. And I can't forget to mention consistency. Consistency has been the key. And most of if you're consistent in anything that you do, one day it's going to be progress, whether it's incremental or just overnight, that's a whole different conversation. But consistency is one of the keys. And then the quality of your work. The NFL is not going to give you the opportunity for you to cover something if you don't, if you show up and just pull the videos upside down and things are shaky and stuff like, they're not going to do that. So for those of you that are watching right now, if you start something, make sure that the quality is what makes the judgment of your character and your commitment other than anything else.
To your point, Lars is aware of this as well, but you know, to get credentialed for any event, right? I mean, even if it's local high school,
right?
Certain quality, college, certain quality, NFL, certain quality. But for the Super Bowl, right? Take me back to the first time you applied NFL credential system.
Right.
And you sent that application off, and then it came back that you were credentialed for the Super Bowl. Do you remember that? I'm sure you do, just because it was.
Of course I do, yeah. You know, first of all, if you go online and look up the credentials for the NFL, you know, you see a whole bunch of people complaining, oh, I applied. I'm a big deal. I applied, and I got denied, and da-da-da, all kinds of stuff, right? So it took me years before I could actually apply, because I had to look at all the protocols of what they require. Mm-hmm. And then also understanding it's just actually, this is the first time that we could actually use cell phones to capture different images for different.
They changed the policy. NFL.
So the thing is, you have to look at the policies, number one. You know, first of all, before you even start looking at the policies, do you have a website as a media outlet? Do you have your social media as a media outlet? Do you have your social media connected, whether it's Twitter, you know, Instagram, Facebook, you know, any levels of social media, are they connected? You know, once you go past that, then, you know, you start now, it becomes a numbers game. You know, what communities am I targeting? For example, like I said, we target people of color because we know that those are marginalized communities. So therefore, they deserve to get stories that are never told by the big guys, right? So the NFL is smart enough to see that this is how we can reach people who may not really look like us, or people who may not really follow us in different aspects. So they know that. So they will give you that opportunity. But you have to do, you know, the groundwork first.
Then and you're being too kind. You have to be good. You don't get a pass just because you're a person of color or you're from Harare, Zimbabwe, like some of us, or Addis Ababa, or you have to be good. So, all right, and time is up. And time is always up. Time is
yes, sir.
And well, we'll get you back. So, thank you for fitting us in, David. It's an honor to have you, and just all the things that you do. Lars, anything, one last word before we go?
I was going to say, you hit the nail on the head. It's not just, and that's what I think people do not appreciate or tend to miss when they view that entire story. Oh, hey, why is he getting a lot of report this and I'm not? It's like, if you come from a humble background, you are humble or you're not. You are good or you're not. You can write or you can't. You can get better over time. You can get humbled in time. But everyone's background is so unique, and that's why you need to have a unique group of people reporting on another unique group of people. You know, not every player is going to understand every reporter, but that's why you want to have a good mix out there. And I think that's why every single year it seems to be getting better. And, you know, Davis being down there is another example of that.
All right. And we got to go. So we got to be good at cutting it off. So thank you so much, Davis.
I appreciate it. Hey, I'll see you backstage. I know where to find you. You know, we always take a few minutes to talk, right?
I will. I'll give you a call. Thank you for showing up. Lars, as always, thank you for being on the ride. And D-Money couldn't have done it without you. Way to pull the levers behind the screen. And you all that are listening. So, again, want to thank Davis Chirwa. I want to thank Peter Hattrup and Pete Ewing. All right. That's it. We're out.
Thank you, brothers. Okay, take care. Bye-bye. Yep. This is